Okay, so now let's move on to this eager design. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is, you know, here's transaction one, here's transaction two, and let's say that this transaction has done a read of A and maybe a write of B. Okay, so previously when I was doing a write, I was not telling anyone else that I was doing a write. Okay, and this is me being lazy with my conflict detection. But now I want to let everybody know right away that I'm doing a write to B. Okay, so in this case, you know, let's assume a directory-based protocol for now. Let's assume that I contact my directory, okay, and I say I'm going to do a write to B, so I need the block with exclusive permissions, right? So the directory says that B is, you know, in modified state with core 1, which is, you know, running transaction 1, and so you have the block in modified state over here. Okay, now let's say that transaction T2 comes along and wants to do a read of B. Okay, and so it says, well, I don't have a cache copy, right? And so I need to contact the directory. Directory says that you need to get your latest copy of the block from transaction T1. Okay, and so this message is then forwarded to transaction T1. And for this block, you know, just as before, there are read and write bits, and the write bit is set, saying that I'm in the middle of this transaction and I have modified block B. And so this transaction one says that, you know, until I finish my transaction, I can't make my writes visible to everybody else, okay? Because, you know, there's a possibility I may abort, or, you know, I may have made a whole bunch of changes. And since I'm a transaction, all of these changes have to be made visible to everybody as one atomic unit. And so, you know, I'm not yet ready to show all my changes to everyone else. Okay, so this transaction says that, you know, T2, you can't read this right now because I'm still in the middle of making some changes. I may still make some more changes to the same cache block B. Okay, so you have to wait until my transaction is completely done. Okay, so normally I'm supposed to forward a copy of this block. Instead, what I do is I send a negative acknowledgement to transaction T2, saying that you need to wait because there is a transaction that is working on this block and that has not yet finished. Okay, so transaction T2 says, all right, you know, this is where I've detected a possible conflict. Okay, normally I would have aborted, but now I'm just going to wait until this conflict is resolved. So sometime later, T2, you know, retries this request for B. So it again sends a message to the directory, directory forwards it on. If the transaction is still busy working on B, it again sends a negative acknowledgement. Okay, so ultimately, when transaction T1 is finished, it has to clear out all of its read and write bits, right? So it clears out this bit saying that, yes, I was working on B, but that transaction is finished. So I can clear out all of my read-write bits. So now when T2 makes its attempt, and when T1 receives this forward message, it sends it realizes that it is now done with the transaction. So it sends a copy of B over to transaction T2. And that allows transaction T2 to now read and proceed. Okay, so you know, now when you had a conflict, I detected that right away. And instead of having to do an abort, I just stalled one of these transactions and allowed it to proceed. So this policy is also called a requester stalls policy. Okay, now let's take a case where, you know, here's transaction T3 that also now wants to do a write to B. Okay, so when it wants to do a write to B, it first contacts the directory. You know, this has all changed now, right? So now B is in shared state with transaction 2 right now. So when your directory receives a write request from transaction T3, it says, well, there are other sharers of this block, so I need to first invalidate those blocks. So it sends an invalidation message to transaction T2. Okay, and so this block is in shared state, its read bit is set, and so transaction T2 says, yes, I do have a copy of B, but this is something that I have read within a transaction, and that transaction is not yet finished. Okay, so again, this is a case of a conflict, you know, two different threads trying to read and write B, and you've detected that conflict as soon as it happened. Okay, and we're going to stick to this requester stalls policy, right? So T2 says, well, I'm in the middle of the transaction. Okay, your write has to wait. It's only when I'm done with this transaction, only after I've committed, can you be allowed to proceed with your write of B. Okay, so normally when I receive an invalidation, I send back an acknowledgement. In this case, I send back a negative acknowledgement telling T3 that it has to wait. Okay, so T3 does not proceed with its write at this moment. Sometime later, it tries to do a write again. It again contacts the directory. Directory again forwards a request to T2. if transaction T2 has finished, you know, the read and write bits would have been cleared. So at this point, T2 says it is now safe for me to let others write into this block. So now it sends back an acknowledgement. And this allows T3 to proceed. So again, we eagerly detected this conflict as soon as it happened, and we used a request a stalls policy. That means the second person to get to this block has to wait, and it's only when the first transaction has finished that it allows the second one to proceed with its read or its write. Okay, so that's why this is called eager conflict detection. We can also do eager versioning, where when the block is evicted from cache, you can copy the old value into a log, and you can make this value visible to the rest of the world right away. Okay, but you still have to add some more state so that you can detect a conflict, because even though the block may have overflowed from cache, the transaction is not quite over. Okay, so I won't get into those details right now, but you can see that in this case I'm detecting my conflict as soon as it happens. And there are again some other problem scenarios that could show up. Okay, so let me clarify those. Okay, so when you're doing this request as stalls policy, you could easily have a deadlock situation. Okay, so here's transaction 1 and here's transaction 2. Let's say transaction 1 has, you know, written to A and then is doing a read of B. And likewise, T2 has done a write of B and then later does a read of A. Okay, so, you know, let's say that this happens first, this happens second. Then when you try to do a read of B, you contact the directory. Directory forwards the request over here. T2 says that I'm not ready to pass on the value of B because I'm still in the middle of the transaction. So it sends back a NAC. Same thing happens over here when you try to do a read of A within transaction T2, right? So you contact the directory for A. The directory says that, you know, this guy was the last to write into A. And this one says I'm still in the middle of a transaction, not ready to hand over the block. Here's a negative acknowledgement, right? And so, you know, both of them are essentially sending these NACs to each other, and you will never end up sending the actual block itself, right? Because you have to wait for the transaction to finish, and that's not going to happen because each is waiting on the other thread. Okay, so with this request a stalls policy, and with, you know, with eager conflict detection, and with the request a stalls policy, you can end up having a possible deadlock. Okay, and this is, you know, not very hard to deal with, because if every transaction, you know, has some kind of timestamp that says, you know, how old am I, there's a possibility of a deadlock if a transaction realizes that it has received a NAC from an older transaction, and likewise it has sent a NAC to an older transaction. So if a transaction sees that it is exchanging NACs with older transactions, then it is possible that, you know, there could be a cycle of dependencies, right? So there could be, you know, NACs going this way. And if there is a cycle, then there is a possible deadlock. Okay, so as soon as a transaction realizes that it is exchanging NACs with older transactions, it says that I could be in the middle of a cycle of dependencies. I could be in the middle of a deadlock. So at this point, I'm just going to abort and possibly break the cycle. Okay, and so we've seen so far that there were no aborts, right? When we detected a conflict, we resolved that conflict by letting one transaction wait for the first one to finish. So an abort only happens when there is a possible cycle of dependencies and a possible deadlock. Okay, so at this point, this transaction quietly takes itself out of the running. It aborts and it's going to restart, and hopefully by then this deadlock situation would have been resolved. Okay, so, you know, this eager design, while it has deadlocks, this also reveals the fact that aborts are relatively rare. They only happen when you have the cycle of dependencies. And in the common case, we are doing the right thing, right? So when a conflict happens, instead of charging ahead and then having to abort and restart, we're just waiting. And so that also ends up burning less power, right? So for these reasons, I feel that an eager design is perhaps, you know, better optimized for the common case. It firstly minimizes the chances of an abort. When a conflict does happen, instead of burning power, it just sits and waits. And when it is time to commit, you know, things are fairly fast, because, you know, you've already made your changes visible to everybody else. On a commit, all you're doing is clearing out your read and write bits. And so you've optimized the common case, and you've reduced the occurrence of the uncommon case, which is the abort. So I should also point out that, you know, if I change my policy, if I go from request a stalls to request a wins, you could again avoid these deadlocks from happening. But instead, what could happen is a possible livelock situation, right? If you let the requester win and if you abort yourself, then you know both transactions could constantly be aborting and letting the other transaction win and proceed. Okay, so there are different policies that you could use, and in one case you could have a deadlock, in one case you could have a livelock. So I'm just going to walk through the next few slides to make sure that I didn't miss any of these points. So note that you can also have starvation within an eager implementation. Okay, so here is a case where there's a transaction that wants to do a write to B, but there's a different transaction that may have done a read of B. When this transaction contacts the directory says, well, I need to invalidate all the cache copies, sends an invalidation over here. This transaction is still busy, so it sends back a NAC. Okay, now, while this transaction is still reading, some other transaction might show up, and it tries to do a read of B. It's perfectly safe to have, many read-only copies, right? So when it contacts the directory says, yeah, I have a clean copy of B sitting here. Here is a copy of B, and so this transaction is allowed to proceed. Okay, and if this keeps happening, you can have you could have a never-ending list of transactions that always have a read-only copy. So even though this transaction is finished, there are these other transactions that are still running that have a copy of B. Okay, but as long as somebody else is in the middle of a transaction and has read B, this write keeps getting stopped because there's always somebody that is willing to send it a negative acknowledgement. And so, this transaction that is trying to do a write could end up being stopped for a really long time. Okay, so you need some other mechanisms to handle this case when the transaction realizes that it is being stopped. The directory, for example, could stop forwarding copy of B to everybody else that comes along requesting to read B. Okay, so your starvation scenarios that happen in the lazy scheme can also manifest in this eager scheme as well.